استاذ طب الاطفال نفرولوجي والاي سي يو في جامعه القاهره، وامين عام امين صندوق الجمعيه المصريه لطب وزراعه الكلى في الاطفال، وعضو طبعا من الاعضاء المهمين في جمعيه الاي سي يو. اوكي، هيكلمنا النهارده على assessment of fluid status in critical ill pediatric patients. يا ترى لما يبقى الشخص نفسه intensivist ونفرولوجيست هيقول لنا ايه؟ اتفضل دكتور حافظ.
السلام عليكم، اهلا وسهلا. طبعا بدايه يعني بشكر الاستاذ الدكتور ايهاب والاستاذه الدكتوره علياء قطبي، طبعا المودريتورز بتوعنا النهارده، وطبعا الدكتور طارق والدكتوره حنان والدكتوره ميرفت وكل تيم البيكيو في عين شمس، اللي هم ده المؤتمر ال 12 واللي احنا دايما بنبقى مع بعض الساينتيفيك اكتيفيتيز اللي نرجو ان احنا كلنا ان شاء الله نستفيد منها. طبعا يعني احنا مفروض ان احنا هنتكلم على assessment of fluid status in critical ill pediatric patients. ايه الصورة اللي انا حاططها دي وايه علاقتها بالفلويد ستاتس؟ الصورة دي من اشهر صور التاريخ، اسمها البلو ماربل اللي اتصورت من سفينة الفضاء أبولو 17، وكانت أول صورة حقيقية لكوكب الأرض على بعضه. وطبعا احنا عارفين 70% من سطح الأرض is water بمناسبة الكلام على الفلويد. طبعا كلنا عارفين برضو
دكتور حافظ، بعد اذنك في ريكوست انه في ناس فورنرز كتير فطالبين يبقى التوك ان انجلش اكتر الوقت
ممكن. اوكي يا فندم. زائد انه وي نو ذات 60% اوف ذا هيومن بودي از ووتر، وطبعا ده في الادلت، لكن عندنا في الاطفال ان تشيلدرن total body water could reach 70 or even 80% of the body weight in preterms. The body water is not one compartment. We have the intracellular compartment, which is the main, and the extracellular compartment, which is the compartment more liable to turnover. It's easily lost and easily gained than the intracellular. The extracellular is separated from the intracellular by the cell membrane, and it's the sodium content that determines the distribution between the extracellular and the intracellular compartment of the body. The extracellular is divided into interstitial and the plasma volume. The interstitial fluid is about 4 times the plasma volume, and these are separated by the blood capillary wall, and it's the oncotic pressure inside the blood vessels that determines the fluid balance between both. If you have a low plasma oncotic pressure, for example, due to hypoalbuminemia or increased capillary permeability, you can have fluid shift from the plasma to the interstitial fluid and vice versa. Of course, the packed cell volume, the red cell volume, is technically an intracellular fluid, but together with the plasma, it constitutes the intravascular or the blood volume. زي ما معظم البلد بانكس والبلد دونيشن سيرفيسز ان ذا وورلد بتقول بلد سيفز لايفز، احنا في الاي سي يو ذا سورس از بول مارينو ذا اي سي يو بوك ادلت، بس ما فيش مشكله اننا ناخد منهم. قال ذا بلد فوليوم سيفز لايفز، stressing the importance of hypovolemia, the importance to avoid hypovolemia, that the intravascular volume is a very important factor that determines tissue perfusion, زي ما سمعنا دكتور طارق في البرزنتيشن اللي فاتت عن التيشو perfusion والperfusion pressure. So blood volume saves lives, the intravascular volume is very important. And therefore, it is very important to maintain the intravascular volume in any critically ill patient. زي ما الدكتور إيهاب بيقول in nephrology, a patient who is hypovolemic, hypoperfused, hypotensive, it's usual to have oliguria. This is a compensatory mechanism. It doesn't mean to leave the patient hypovolemic, provided, of course, you are not going to get your patient into a volume overload. And a rapid volume expansion refers to within 5 minutes and not within 1 hour, as many of us have believed falsely before. Fluid resuscitation is not generally associated with increased risk of ARDS or pulmonary edema. Reversal of shock is very important, and delays can be fatal, because we will hear a lot about issues related to conservative fluid approaches, avoidance of fluid overload. This is very important. However, this doesn't mean to keep any patient hypovolemic for any reason, because this could be immediately fatal. ربنا سبحانه وتعالى قال لنا عن المية فأسقيناكم وما أنتم له بخازنين. We don't have a store of fluids in our body, and therefore the water deficit can cause severe consequences. A 10% water deficit consistent with severe dehydration can cause serious illness, and 15% is probably fatal in most people. What's this X-ray? This is a severe form of acute pulmonary edema, which is what we see when a patient is having excess intravascular volume. We commonly see it in renal patients who are anuric and overloaded and present with acute pulmonary edema. So when the intravascular volume is increased, you can get acute pulmonary edema, and this is a fatal condition that can result in cardiopulmonary failure and death. Fluid overload is a problem, and just like dehydration is a problem, fluid overload is also a problem. This study in 2010, and we have tens of studies thereafter emphasizing the same concept, that many ICU patients are overloaded, that overload is a mortality risk, and even small amounts of overload can increase mortality. And again, we were talking about a 10% fluid deficit. A 10% fluid overload can be serious and is the intervention threshold for fluid removal by ultrafiltration in ICU patients. Therefore, the amount of fluid in the body has to be kept constant by maintaining the balance between water intake and water output. This happens naturally in all of us through the thirst mechanism and the urine concentration mechanism to maintain water homeostasis in our bodies. Therefore, if we are talking about assessment of fluids in critically ill children or in anyone, we have to assess intake and output, which is the mechanism by which we maintain fluid homeostasis, the fluid balance, which we do every day in our units. And a very important notice, assessment of intake, output, and fluid balance is essential for every critically ill patient. The patient doesn't have to be oligoric or overloaded or a non-renal patient for you to monitor the fluid balance of this patient. This is a summary of the intake and output of fluid, which we have to assess in our patients. And note that we have an insensible water loss, which all of us know as 400 ml per meter square body surface area. Actually, this 400 is the difference between the insensible water loss and some insensible water gain from metabolism, because metabolism of glucose and fatty acids results in carbon dioxide, water, and energy. This water comes from the metabolism. The difference between the two is what is commonly known as insensible water loss, and it's 400 per meter square of body surface area, as we all know. All our normal maintenance formulas by which we calculate maintenance requirements using body weight or body surface area depend on replacing this insensible loss plus a normal urine output, because sweating and stool are normally minimal if the patient doesn't have diarrhea, and if the patient is hospitalized and therefore is not doing physical effort in a hot, humid weather. So sweat and stool are normally minimal, and there is no abnormal losses. Then the maintenance requirements equal the insensible loss plus the normal urine output. And we give this maintenance in the form of medications, transfusions, nutrition, enteral feeding, and IV fluids. That's what we do every day. We calculate the normal maintenance. We subtract the obligatory intakes, the medications and the transfusions and nutrition and so on. And the remaining we give it as IV fluids. But please note that the normal maintenance is calculated based on a normal urine output, and that abnormal losses are minimal or absent. So if your patient is oligoric or polyuric or having diarrhea or having other abnormal losses, you cannot use normal maintenance formulas as maintenance fluid prescriptions. The first thing you have to do is assess and act upon intake and output. We don't like to hear that the patient yesterday had a pulse of positive 1,000. Okay, where were you when it was positive 100 and positive 200 and 300? You have to act on it. You don't just record the fluid balance. The management of fluid support depends on, usually, on prescription of intake. احنا دايما لما بنتكلم على fluid management بنتكلم عايزين ندي الpatient fluids قد ايه. وعندنا طريقتين في هذا, either by normal maintenance بالمعادلات or by monitored output. If the patient is having an abnormal urine or is having abnormal losses, you have to monitor the actual output and determine what your patient needs as maintenance. You can't say, okay, the patient is 1 square meter, needs 1,500 ml per 24 hours, and this patient is having drains that are oozing blood, is having diarrhea, is having polyuria. All this makes the normal maintenance formula completely useless. You have to monitor the patient's actual output, and therefore replacing this together with the insensible losses will be the intake. But remember, we always concentrate on intake. You can change the output. You can change the output by giving a diuretic if the patient is going to respond, and by ultrafiltration using peritoneal dialysis, hemodialysis, or continuous renal replacement therapies, as we know. So don't forget that aspect of treatment. The other very important question is your real aim to maintain meaning. Does any patient you see, it will be good, you will be doing the patient a good job if you give the patient exactly the same as the output? Not always, really, because the question is the current condition optimal? I am dehydrated. If the patient is dehydrated, then definitely you need to give more than the maintenance. If the patient is presenting with fluid overload and edema, then definitely your target is to have the patient in a negative balance. So take care of this. There are some obvious scenarios. A patient with acute blood loss, you need to replace that. A patient with severe dehydration, you need to give the deficit together with your maintenance, and then you will get a positive balance tomorrow, of course. A patient with pulmonary edema and anuria, you don't need to give fluids, and you are likely to need to remove fluids, whether by a diuretic response or by ultrafiltration or dialysis. There are many less obvious scenarios where المواضيع مش دايما straightforward, and good luck in the assessment. But take care. There are usually three stages in a critically ill child. A critically ill child early will usually present in a condition requiring resuscitation, in a volume responsive condition. And in the initial phase, you will likely be giving a positive balance, giving a lot of fluid, for example, in the early stage of sepsis or hemorrhage or and so on. And then the patient is usually, you have a problem that the patient is having multiple organ dysfunction, is having fluid retention, is having myocardial dysfunction, is having low cardiac output, is having acute kidney injury, and you have to give smaller amounts of fluid, and then with improvement, the patient gradually develops diuresis and mobilization of fluid, and then you can give more fluids. So we are talking about three phases: an early resuscitation phase, a fluid retention phase where you have to restrict fluid intake and maybe remove fluid, and then an improvement phase where you can give a bit more fluids according to the patient's balance. الموضوع ان انت مش عارف العيان جاي لك في انهي phase. Maybe the patient is coming already in a fluid retention and volume overload phase. And therefore, you need not only to assess the fluid balance, intake and output, but the question is, what is the current fluid status? Meaning, is the patient dehydrated? Is the patient retaining fluid with extracellular fluid? Is the patient hypovolemic? Is the patient hypervolemic, talking about the intravascular compartment and the total body fluid compartment? Of course, we know dehydration, there is a lot. Many scores and many protocols, and all of us know the signs of dehydration. We usually don't have a problem with recognizing dehydration. Increase in extracellular fluid, which is the opposite of dehydration, we can detect it by a weight gain. Okay, when you see the patient for the first time, you don't have the sign of weight gain. But if a patient has been admitted to your unit weighing 12 kilograms and now he's 14 kilograms, that's almost a 20% overload, because definitely the patient has not gained 2 kilograms of lean body weight in just a few days. So admission weight and today's weight can be very beneficial. If you track the balance and you find the fluid balance that's yesterday positive 500 and the day before positive 700 and the day before positive 800, this patient is definitely retaining fluid. Oliguria can be the cause of fluid retention, but also can be a consequence of dehydration. And therefore, the main sign of increased extracellular fluid is edema, which you look for in the form of peripheral edema, in the form of ascites, in the form of pulmonary edema, maybe if it's severe, and evidence of hypervolemia. So the assessment here, the extracellular fluid, is there dehydration? Is there edema? Dehydration has many grades and many scores, which we are all aware of. Edema, unfortunately, there is no reliable score that can tell you if you have mild lower limb edema and mild facial edema and no ascites, this is a 5% edema. This is not accurate, and therefore it's a bit more difficult than assessing dehydration. Now, dehydration and edema, we're referring to the total amount of water, particularly the extracellular compartment of the patient. The intravascular compartment is more critical, as we said. The blood volume, a slight increase or a slight decrease, can be much more harmful than the same increase or decrease in the total body fluid compartment. How to diagnose intravascular overfilling? If the patient is having pulmonary congestion, you can know that clinically, you can know that by radiology, you can do that by ultrasonography, by something called B lines, we will see it in a while. If a patient develops hepatomegaly, this could be a sign of congestion, as we all know. Congested neck veins, increased central venous pressure. Distended non-collapsible inferior vena cava can be seen by bedside ultrasonography, and many intensive care units have this and do it now almost routinely. Hypertension, tachycardia, and tachypnea as consequences, and direct blood volume monitoring, which is not readily available in all units. Note that all these signs are actually signs of systemic and pulmonary venous congestion. So we are taking signs of systemic and pulmonary congestion to indicate that the patient could be hypervolemic, hypovolemia. Now, this slide shows mostly the signs of low cardiac output. And therefore, hypovolemia is indirectly evidenced by the presence of low cardiac output signs. However, low cardiac output, generally, low cardiac output signs generally denote hypovolemia. Systemic and pulmonary congestive symptoms and signs generally denote hypervolemia, provided the heart is doing its job well. Because if you have myocardial dysfunction, you can get low cardiac output. The patient is not hypovolemic. The heart is just not pumping. And you can get systemic and pulmonary congestive symptoms without hypervolemia. You can get high CVP, congested neck veins, hepatomegaly, pulmonary edema without hypervolemia, just because the heart is not doing its job well. And therefore, assessment of cardiac function is part of assessment of fluid status. If you have a patient with sepsis or severe hypoalbuminemia, this patient may have a capillary leak and therefore may have a hypovolemia despite edema. There is edema, but the intravascular volume is shrunken because of fluid shift from the vessels to the interstitial fluid secondary to the capillary leak and hypoalbuminemia. So not always the patient who is edematous is hypervolemic. Not always the patient who is having congestive symptoms is hypervolemic. Interpret this taking into account cardiac function, oncotic pressure, and capillary leak that's present. So how to determine the current fluid status? Weigh the patient, track the fluid balance, very important, very simple, commonly overlooked. Signs of edema, dehydration, hypo and hypervolemia, taking into account myocardial function, as we have just said. We have some supplemental tools that may help in that. Central venous pressure has been discussed very nicely باي دكتور طارق في البرزنتيشن اللي فاتت. في ناس بتقول سي في بي حلو وفي ناس بتقول سي في بي وحش. هو حلو في ايه وحش في ايه؟ A patient with a CVP of 20 definitely is having venous congestion, and someone with a negative CVP is definitely hypovolemic. However, what is the optimum CVP for a particular patient? There is a lot of variation that depends on cardiac function and individual responses and other hemodynamic factors. So there is a range in which whether the optimum CVP is 5, is 10, is 12, is 8, there is a range where it can vary. This is the inferior vena cava. The inferior vena cava, we can easily see it in a longitudinal subcostal view by bedside ultrasound. And if we put an M mode, we can see that the inferior vena cava during there are respiratory changes in the diameter of the inferior vena cava. During spontaneous breathing, inspiration causes a collapse. And during mechanical ventilation, inspiration causes a distension in the inferior vena cava. And there have been many studies trying to measure this and correlate size and collapse and distension with both fluid status and volume responsiveness. Some studies say this is wonderful, this is good, this is easy, and some give really harsh criticisms. The darajat in ihna nlaqi publication sanat 2019 unwanha the dark art of inferior vena cava ultrasound. ايه الموضوع؟ هو حلو ولا وحش؟ Okay. The issue is IVC ultrasound needs to be standardized. This is the issue. Where to measure, how to normalize for patient size. There are now curves for IVC diameter, effect of breathing, effect of patient size. CVP is not always the good gold standard to compare with, as we know. However, we have data from our unit. It is very clear that this one is a collapsed IVC, and this one is a distended IVC, okay? This one is non-collapsed. Maybe you can say it's a normal IVC. And if you put an M mode, you can see the collapse of the IVC. So this IVC is distended, but it collapses with respiration, and therefore this patient may still be volume responsive. Based on this, we can classify inferior vena cava, just semi-quantitatively, into a collapsed IVC denoting hypovolemia, an uncollapsed IVC, which may be normal and may be fluid responsive, a distended collapsible IVC, which can have differences in interpretation, and a distended non-collapsible, which means the patient is clearly overloaded and is clearly not volume responsive. And we had actually a correlation between this grading and the fluid requirements of the patients, and this data will be published soon, inshallah. Echocardiography, I'm not discussed into that, but myocardial function is a part of fluid assessment. Chest imaging is important. Chest X-ray ultrasound, the picture we see is a lung ultrasound showing these white lungs, these white lines known as B lines. They denote pulmonary edema or pulmonary congestion. When you see this, the patient is overloaded or having pulmonary edema. The last supplemental tool, we have central venous pressure, IVC, echo, chest imaging, and bioimpedance. Bioimpedance بيستعملوه في الفتنس وفي الرجيم لتحديد body water content. And we have this device, the electrical cardiometry device. It basically measures stroke volume, cardiac output, and systemic vascular resistance for hemodynamic measurement, but it can measure the thoracic fluid content, the lung water, the extravascular water in the lung by bioimpedance, and changes in this can be very helpful during fluid resuscitation and management. The most important thing of these tools is the trend and the response to intervention. CVP is good, CVP is bad. Okay, the CVP is 8. You give a volume, the CVP becomes 10. The blood pressure improves, the mixed venous saturation improves. So the patient has responded to this fluid challenge you have given. So it's very important to monitor the trend and the change in these parameters. Got it? If we are going to assess fluids, we need to know what is the fluid balance, what is the current fluid status, and what is volume responsiveness. Volume responsiveness is based on the Starling curve we see. If we are here, then giving volume, increasing preload will increase the stroke volume and cardiac output. If we are here, then the extra volume will not be pumped and will lead to congestion and will harm the patient. Volume responsiveness means an increase in the stroke volume in response to volume expansion. Very basically, if you give the patient volume, the stroke volume increases, the patient is volume responsive. The issue is that volume responsiveness does not necessarily mean that the patient must receive fluids. If a volume responsiveness means that if the cardiac output is low and you need to increase the cardiac output, giving volume might help. Volume non-responsiveness means that giving volume is likely to harm. So how to know whether the patient is volume responsive? Urine, capillary refill, blood pressure, lactate, all these are poor predictors of volume responsiveness. They are good predictors of other things, such as tissue perfusion, cardiac output, and organ function. However, they are not good predictors of volume responsiveness. CVP, chest X-ray, echo, lung ultrasound can determine that a patient is not volume responsive. If a patient is having a very high CVP, is having evidence of lung congestion, okay, then this patient clearly will not be volume responsive. The actual response to volume, give the patient volume and see if the patient improves. The problem is if you give too much volume and the patient is not volume responsive, then you cannot reverse this and you have harmed your patient. There is something called the FALS protocol. It's an ultrasound protocol that's based on using serial chest ultrasound and giving small fluid boluses. And once you find B lines in the lung, this means this patient is starting not to be volume responsiveness, and it's known as fluid administration limited by lung sonography or FALS protocol. Just give a small bolus and check the chest, another small bolus, check the chest. Once you see a change, then stop. The patient will not benefit from further fluid management. There are some dynamic tests that help to predict volume responsiveness before giving fluid. All of them depend on one very simple thing. If a patient is on a ventilator, a positive pressure ventilation will decrease the venous return, and therefore it will decrease the cardiac filling, and therefore during inspiration, you will find changes in systolic blood pressure, in pulse pressure, and in stroke volume, and these changes can be measured if you have invasive monitoring. If you use the cardiometry, the bioimpedance cardiometry, it can tell you the stroke volume variability. And if you use invasive blood pressure monitoring, you can determine the systolic blood pressure variability. This variability denotes volume responsiveness. When the mechanical ventilation decreases the venous return, there is a decrease in the blood pressure, there is a decrease in the pulse pressure, there is a decrease in the stroke volume that's reversed during expiration. This means if you give fluid, the patient is likely to respond. The other method is end expiratory occlusion. Basically the same thing. If a patient is on a ventilator and then you put an end expiratory occlusion, you stop inspiration by the ventilator, provided the patient is not going to develop severe hypoxia, of course, then this is as if you give the patient fluid because you stop the mechanical ventilation-induced decrease in the venous return. So when you stop that, you give the patient a fluid, an endogenous fluid bolus, you find that the blood pressure increases, the stroke volume increases, and so on. This predicts volume responsiveness. The same effect of passive leg raising, and there are many studies about that. If the patient's condition permits, if you raise the patient's legs, then the blood in the patient's legs is going to go to the heart. So it's as if you give a fluid bolus to the patient, and this fluid, if the patient improves in response to this fluid bolus, the patient is likely to be fluid responsive. Therefore, fluid responsiveness is something that's different from dehydration or overload. It determines whether an increase in the fluid bolus will be capable of increasing the stroke volume or not. So therefore, if we talk about fluid assessment and monitoring, we have three very big titles. The first, the intravascular and the total fluid status. Is the patient hypovolemic? Is the patient hypervolemic? Is the patient edematous? Is the patient dehydrated? Okay. And take into account myocardial function. Is the patient volume responsiveness? So if the patient has low cardiac output, will volume lead to an improvement or will lead to a congestion? This is another question. The third question is, What is the intake? What is the output? What is the balance? How am I going to maintain the fluid homeostasis in the patient, which we all daily maintain through the thirst mechanism and the urine concentration, but your patient is critical and may have renal affection, so this mechanism is not intact. And then your management will depend on prescribing a fluid intake, fluid boluses, maintenance fluids, replacement of defects, and output modification. Don't forget, you have tools other than prescribing fluids. You can give diuretics if the patient responds, and you can remove fluids by ultrafiltration if the patient needs. In conclusion, most of the human body is water. You don't have a store, so a deficiency or an excess can be serious. In most sick children, fluid homeostasis is maintained by prescribing fluids. You see the output and you get an equal input or more or less depending on the patient's condition. Output can be increased by diuretics and ultrafiltration. Critically ill children usually follow three phases: resuscitation, restriction, and diuresis sequence. Assessment should include total and intravascular volume because they don't always match each other. Follow and act on the fluid balance of the patient. Clinical assessment monitoring trends may be combined with some bedside tools and tests like bedside ultrasonography, like impedance cardiometry, like hemodynamic monitoring, like echocardiography, like CVP monitoring, and so on. But there is no single best tool. You have to use a combination of factors to get an idea on your patient. And lastly, volume responsiveness is a very important concept that refers to the potential for volume administration to increase the stroke volume. Will Shatara Inactive predict this and to give volume when it will help your patient? And thank you.